Cover security, everyone in the right place?
Yeah.
No.
Cool. All right. You always gotta check. That's a key pro tip if you ever become a professor. Okay. So, little introduction. So this, does it sound echoey to everyone? A little bit? It's kind of annoying. All right. So this is Software Security, CSE 545. For those that don't know me, I'm Adam Dupay. I'm a professor here in computer science at CIDSE. I've been doing this now for 3 years. I started in August 2014. Before here, I got 3 degrees from UC Santa Barbara. So I got essentially the equivalent of a 4+1 there. So a master's plus 1 year for, or a bachelor's plus 1 year for a master's. Did that and decided I'm so done with school. I'm never coming back to academia. I want to go work and make a lot of money. So I had a full-time job at Microsoft. And I was there for about, I think like 4 or 5 months before I realized, like, I loved it, don't get me wrong. But what I really missed was doing research, because I got involved in research when I was doing my master's. So then I decided to leave Santa Barbara, or to leave Microsoft and go back to Santa Barbara for my PhD. And so when I was there, I did basically my dissertation on how to automatically find vulnerabilities in web applications through either black box interactions or by source code analysis. And so I did that, and then I was fortunate enough to come here, and I've been here ever since. Any questions about me? It's okay, you don't have to be shy. Yes?
What did you do at Microsoft?
At Microsoft, I was a software developer, or what they call in there, an SDE, which is like a software developer engineer, I think. And I worked internally I was on the big Windows Server team on the user experience group. And so basically we created tools to help technical writers write and manage their technical content. Because they wanted, you know, so basically the technical writers would write using one of our tools, XML, which it turns out technical writers love the idea of XML because you can then spit it out into different formats, but they actually hate writing XML itself. So we developed tools to help them make that process easier for them. Then they would basically check it into our content management system, and then we had various pipelines to publish it to MSDN or create a help file. So when you hit like F1 in your program, you'd see the same help content you saw there as you saw on the web. So yeah, it was really fun. I liked it a lot. I wanted to get more into security, and I just decided, I found out I really love doing research, so. And now I'm here, back in academia, where I said I'd never be, so never say never. Any other questions about me? Cool. Okay, so we have office hours, we'll be updating them shortly. I'd like to introduce you to your TAs. Where did Dylan go? Connor, stand up. You want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, so my name is Connor Nelson. I kind of recognize some of you. I am a 4+1 student here at ASU, so I'm currently in my master's, just graduated with my bachelor's last semester. I took this course with Adam last year. Definitely a good course. You picked the right one. I do research with Adam, and I'll be in this course's TA.
Great. Other Adam, you want to introduce yourself?
My name is Adam Host.
Let's go to our handy dandy syllabus. This is something I guess we don't have to do, but basically you're going to be doing this all day. But as soon as we get through the syllabus stuff, we're going to go right into actual stuff. So this should be fun. Okay, so let's see. Important things. So we have this, so there's 3 of us, right? TAs plus us. So when I've had this happen before, the most annoying, I guess I shouldn't say that. One annoying thing that students can do is to ask all 3 of us the exact same question, but not email all of us in the same email. So we each get a message, we each individually respond, and now you've wasted like 3 people's time. So to prevent that from happening, and to ensure that you get a quick response to your queries, because you guys have questions, I'm frequently very busy and I have a lot of things going on, so sometimes emails get them among other emails. And so that way, if you email this alias, so cse545-admin@asu.edu, that will go to all three of us. So somebody will respond to you right as quickly as possible. So please, please, please use this for all communications with the TAs and professors. So this is the absolute best way to get a hold of us. Questions about that? All right, cool. Okay, so about this course, so the course, the description of this course. Essentially, this is a class on software insecurity. So, is that like crooked on the edge there? Can you all see the board? It's still readable, even though it's in three dimensions. Okay, so the idea behind this course is we want to study the ways in which software can be insecure and can introduce, and vulnerabilities can be introduced. This is incredibly important because without knowing how to find, identify, and exploit vulnerabilities, how can you ever build defenses against those vulnerabilities? So we're really gonna study in a hands-on way, not only the theory, but also the practicality behind exploits and vulnerabilities. So this is really the key behind this course. For prereqs, this course you can talk to the TAs, Adam or Connor. They can tell you that hopefully, I don't know, maybe, is this course hard or challenging, difficult?
Yes.
Requires a lot of time commitment?
A lot of time, a lot of programming.
Yes, a lot of time, a lot of, and I didn't pay them to say that. They didn't know they were gonna be speaking off the cuff here, so you can at least mildly trust what they say. So this is, not only is this course challenging, but this is also a grad class. So this is not an undergrad class. I'm not going to spoon feed you about, I don't know, how to do things. I trust that you're all at the level where you can, if you don't know something, not knowing something is fine, right? We all start in a state of not knowing something. So do you just give up your hands and cry like, oh, I don't know, like, woe is me? No, you go out there and you learn what you need to learn in order to accomplish what you need to do. So that is what I'll expect of you. Of course, we're your resource, so us and, as you'll see, your fellow students. So feel free to ask those questions, but on the same time, you should be focusing on finding the answers yourself, and you'll find that that's a very rewarding process. So some of the things that, so like Connor and Adam said, it's a very programming intensive course. It's also a very hands-on course. This is not a theoretical computer security course. So in order to succeed at this course, you need to be a very good programmer, or you will become a very good programmer by the end of this course. I highly recommend you know C or C++ very well, because a lot of we're gonna look at C code, we're gonna be looking at assembly, and if you've never seen these kind of things before, you will have to spend the time to learn them beforehand. It's also very handy to know a scripting language, either Python, Ruby, or something like PHP, and a really solid background in operating systems, and I'm gonna update this, because Connor made a good point, networking. So networking, sockets, IP, we're gonna cover these things. We're gonna cover these things in context of attacks, though. So while I'll briefly cover the basics, you're gonna have to learn on your own what the structure of a IP header or TCP header looks like if you don't already know those things. There you go, this is a good line. If you don't have these skills or don't plan on acquiring them, you will not succeed in this course. So there's no shame in not taking a course. This just may not be for you. Questions on prereqs? Cool. All right, textbooks. So there's nothing, most of this material is compiled from my knowledge of security, as well as borrowed from some other professors and that I've improved upon. So I don't teach from a textbook, but these two textbooks I know have been useful for students. So if you're looking for something to buy or something to have as a resource, these are actually fantastic resources. So Hacking the Art of Exploitation is, I don't know if it's not in this class, but I know a student who has taken that, read this book and has become like very good at doing binary analysis and finding binary vulnerabilities. So it's a very good book. Also, the Web Application Hacker's Handbook is a great book for web security. So I actually, I own, I think there are 4 copies of this Hacking Art of Exploitation book, because I keep lending them out to students, and they like it so much they don't return it, which is good. And this other book is really awesome, too, for web security. This is like the web security Bible. All right, cool. Course communication. So as you'll notice, well, maybe as you'll notice, as I will tell you directly, I do not like Blackboard, so I will not use Blackboard for this course at all. So this website will be your, will tell you everything that's going on here. We'll also use a Google group for class discussion and class communication. So basically you have to sign up for this, because anything, like if I say, hey, class is canceled, and you all go, yay, you'll know about that through the mailing list. If I say we have a pop quiz, but anyways, whatever. All announcements will go through this list, plus the really important thing, like if you look around this room, there's 132 people enrolled in this course. There are 3 people trying to help everyone in this. So this course will be much better if you end up helping each other, right? And the best way to do that is to ask questions on the mailing list where your fellow students can see them and can say, hey, did you check out this resource? This may have the answer to your question. Or, oh, have you tried looking? Or how are you opening that file? All these kinds of things will help a lot. So I strongly encourage you to use the course mailing list. Also, what we'll do is if we get a question from one of you that is not a personal or some kind of restricted question, oftentimes we'll reply and include the course mailing list. That way, again, when one of you has this question, it's likely that many have the same question. So if we reply on the mailing list, so another good tip is to search this before you ask your question, because this happens, I think, less in grad classes, much more in undergrad classes, where students will ask the same question like 4 times and wonder why nobody's replying to them. And it's because like 2 days ago somebody asked that same question and they already had an answer. So that's good. Don't share solutions and answers. That's pretty easy, cool topics. We'll cover so we'll look at network attacks and how to attack networks. We'll look at application security, and mainly we'll focus on binary security, so how to identify vulnerabilities and exploit them in binaries. And then web security, we'll look at how to identify and exploit vulnerabilities in web applications. So those will be the 3 main areas covering all kinds of these cool technologies. All right, there'll be a number of homework assignments that may vary depending on how much time we have and how things go. There'll be a midterm exam, no notes or material. There will be a project for this course. I need to update this. There will be a project. This is for those MCS students that are doing the project portfolio. This course will count as that. There'll be a final exam. This is how the grading is split. I don't know, this is all stuff I feel like you can read in your own time. So let's see. Late assignments, 20% deduction per day that your assignment is late. That's on you. For all of the assignments, I think. Yeah, for all the assignments, they'll basically be automated grading, so you'll know right away what your exact grade is on that submission that you made. So that should be pretty easy. Any questions before we get to the super fun part about plagiarism? No, as if it wasn't fun already. Okay. So I have to do this because it ends up being an issue every single semester. I'll start out by saying I don't want to write anyone up for academic integrity violations. I don't want to have to report you to the dean's office. But when we find people cheating, we will do those things. And the reason why is because it's not fair to everyone else in the course who put in a bunch of time and effort and struggled and spent, I don't know, do you have a rough estimate for how long you spent on an assignment? You don't want to know. Yeah, when you put in all this effort and then somebody else puts in 0 efforts and copies from their friends, that's not good for anyone, right? So I do take plagiarism and cheating very seriously, even though this is a grad class. So consider this your essentially first warning, because you will not get any other warnings. When we find stuff, we go through the procedures and we will write you up. I do care. I care about all of you, but just because you're in certain circumstances, you're here from out of the country, your parents are paying for your loans, I honestly feel bad for you, but your actions have consequences, and so it's not fair to all the other students who put in the work. So I've written up every single person that I've caught cheating, and so that's just, I guess, a fair warning. So basically, so it's a 0 on the assignment, and it'll be reported to the dean's office. So just don't do it. That way, I don't want to increment this number. Like, I always have to increment this number. so don't make me do that. So in case it's not clear at all, so examples of academic integrity violations, sharing code with a student, right? So sharing, hey, use this snippet. So, and then this is, you know, it's if it's a, how do I open a file or something, like, I guess that could be more fine. If it's like, hey, here's this web page that tells you how to open a, open a file. But if you're coding somebody else's code or they send you snippets, don't do that, we're gonna find it, it's not gonna be good. Collaborating with a student on code, submitting another student's code as your own, this is a big one. I've seen people not even change the name. Yeah, like here's a README file with your name, and here's C code with at the top of it with somebody else's name. Submitting a prior student's code as your own, so this is another one. So getting code from previous semesters, we have all the code, we run cheating detection stuff. Just don't do it. Like, I don't know. I hope you're here because you want to learn and expand your horizons and become security experts. And the only way you're going to do that is to put in the time and the effort. Like, we're not asking you to do busy work stuff. We're just asking you to code things because you need to know how to code to do security. So, in the kind of corollary to this is posting your projects online is expressly forbidden. We can retroactively fail you, and that has happened to people. So don't do that. And a lot of students say that, I want my projects to be out there so that my potential employers maybe can find it and use it. That is great, but there's a GitHub student developer pack where you get unlimited private repositories, so you can make your repos private. And actually, this is actually a key thing. So everyone does projects in school, right? So employers aren't really impressed that you took a course and you were forced to do this homework assignment, right? Because you literally are doing that for the grade. What employers want to see, and this is something coming from my year, I guess I can't even say plural, my year at Microsoft, is that what impresses me when I'm looking at a resume is, hey, here's this open source code that I wrote. This is something I didn't have to do, but I did anyways because I thought it was cool and fun. That really stands out to employers, not, hey, I coded thing X that 200,000 other people across the country also coded that thing, right? So, all right, any questions? So let's, super fun plagiarism, don't do it, et cetera, et cetera. All right, cool. Class over, no, I'm just kidding. Can't let that sit for. So now we will get right to it. So, what is software security? What is this course going to be? Well, we first need to think about what is security. So I'm asking you, what is security? What do you think? What is the word, the term? How do we use the word security? You don't have to be shy. You're trying to buy 131 of your friends.
Protection.
What was that?
Protection.
Protection against what?
Against an attack, outside attack.
What's an attack?
Someone trying to take your data and you don't want to share your data.
Okay, someone trying to take your data. What else? Yeah.
An unauthorized
person should not be able to access what?
My private data.
Private data? Okay, cool. What else? Yeah.
Confidential information.
Confidential information? What does that mean?
Maybe the credit card is the confidential information.
So like a person, so like a private
person,
like
or a company. You know, a company has a lot of employees. If this kind of information exposed, so the company may run into a lot of problems.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
I guess controlling interaction with just about anything in a process.
Ooh, security, so controlling any types of interactions? Interesting. Yeah.
A person should not be able to manipulate the data that I want to send.
So maybe, so unauthorized modification of data either at rest or in transit, that's pretty good. Cool, yeah.
Defining what a person can do as in the system.
Say that again, sorry.
Defining what a person can do.
Defining what a person can do in the system. Yeah, so kind of all these things. So basically when we think about security, we break it down into three things. This is incredibly important things that you really have to drill into your head. About what is security. So broadly, we think about security in three different ways. And you think of it, the acronym CIA is very easy to remember. So confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So confidentiality, we want to keep things that we want to be private, private, right? Other people phrase it other ways. We want to allow people access only who should have access, right? These are all kind of ways of thinking about confidentiality. So keeping secret things secret. Integrity is what we talked about with modification, right? If I send my stockbroker a message that says, hey, buy 1,000 shares of whatever, Apple, and somebody changes it to say, buy 1,000,000 shares of Apple, right? That would be bad for me. Or if they change it and say, sell all of my shares of Apple, that would be another bad thing, right? So I want to make sure that that message that I send, the other party knows that that data doesn't remain changed in transit. So availability, why? So what is availability?
Access control.
What was that?
Access control.
Access control, define it. And relate it to availability.
Yeah. So from a sort of systems level, a user can only access what he's supposed to access. That's how I would define access control.
Okay, what about availability?
So being able to access something is how it is to you.
Okay, interesting. I buy that. There's another one,
Yeah, so when we want to access a particular data, no one should prevent us from accessing that data.
Okay. Yeah, so actually that's interesting. I never thought of it like that. But it's almost the flip side of confidentiality, right? So if we want something to be confidential, that means only authorized people should be able to see that, right? So from a confidentiality perspective, if I can see something but I can't because that system is down, then it's still confidential, right? But it's made unavailable. So actually one of the good attacks I like thinking about availability. So the big thing everyone thinks of is denial of service, right? You just take down some system. But one of the coolest things I heard about is when criminals are going to do a physical or even digital bank robbery, what they'll do is they'll set up a thing that will send all the IT admins and basically spam them, but not with, like, I don't know, links to buy Viagra. What they'll do is they'll just send them emails with random gibberish that gets through their spam filters because it's literally nonsense, but it fills up their inbox so they don't see the alerts that are happening of, oh, we tripped this intrusion detection system, or oh, this system, or oh, there's a weird suspicious transaction that's happening. So that's an interesting attack on the availability of a person, or the availability to like see alerts. So what we're gonna look at with software insecurity is, we're gonna be looking a lot at terms of software faults. So what are the ways that software can be incorrect? So why, if we step back for a moment, why do we even have to do this? Shouldn't software be perfect and just work? Our entire lives and everything runs on software, right? I mean, there's software running literally, airplanes, your car, everywhere. Yeah?
Hardware can't be imperfect.
Hardware can be imperfect. Yeah, that's a good response. I love that idea. Let's blame it on the hardware people, right? So, even if we write perfectly, 100% correct software, the hardware could be wrong. And we're actually seeing examples of that in some recent vulnerabilities now. What else? Why else? Has any of you written software that is 100% correct? It doesn't exist. Interesting. I don't know how to think about that. It's all ignored.
Isn't it because of abstraction? You're always writing software on another layer who you don't really
ask. Let's say my goal is to write 100% secure software. If abstraction was the problem, then I'll just get rid of abstraction, right? And just do it. Right? I'll write to the hardware directly, or maybe I'll write in assembly or something.
And more often than not, you don't have the budget or the time to.
Yeah. But even if, let's say you gave me, I don't know, how much money do you want? How much money is it going to take? $10 million, $100 million, $1 billion?
Yeah, to do with.
Could you still guarantee at the end that you have something that's 100% secure?
Human error.
Yeah, who's the human that's usually at fault?
The intern.
Broadly, I think of it as people, there's many different ways. This is kind of a pretty broad question, but I think of it as like software is developed by humans and we're not perfect, therefore the software that we develop can almost never be perfect. And that doesn't even include things like hardware or configuration or all these different ways that we're gonna learn that software can break because of things that aren't necessarily the cause of the person who wrote it, but. And so we think of it as basically, you know, a developer mistake or human error introduces some bug. So what's the difference between like a bug and a security error? So what's an example of a bug? So
if the functionality doesn't work, it might be a bug. But if it works perfectly in the functional perspective, but from the security perspective, something breaks, then it's not.
Right. So from so correctness, so there's an idea of functionality or what things it should do. So if it's something wrong with the functionality, that could be a bug. But what are some examples of bugs? Like, well, you've never stared at like a compiler error before that said you did something wrong? Yeah.
Bug is a general keyword which can be defined. You know, there are a lot of bugs. For example, in the user experience of an application, maybe there's some bug in one of the drop-down buttons and it does not work correctly. But it does not necessarily mean that it may be caused any security, security vulnerability and something like that. But when you are talking about security, it means that there is a vulnerability which is comes from bugs, but it's a vulnerability that can cause some access to the program from outside of it, and they can change the integrity of the system.
So when we think about it, right? So we think about, are all software faults security bugs? Probably no, right? So let's say anybody work at a company and have like a bug tracker, work with bug trackers. Yeah. What are some examples of bugs that you've seen generally? Maybe. What was it? No. Like, what's an example of a bug? Like, can you give me like a broad example? You don't have to give us any details.
Like a corner case, an unanticipated corner case with like multiple like scenarios.
Yeah, so I had an example, I think it was when I was an intern at Microsoft, and so we had SDETs, which were dedicated testing people, and they came up with found this bug in some thing that I had done where they said, it works right most of the time, but if you have two monitors and you're on the secondary monitor, the feature that I implemented didn't work. And that like blew my mind at the time, like why would anybody test it on two monitors, but they were right, that was a bug, but that wasn't necessarily a security bug. Or like, I've had bugs where like, change this text from this to this because that's what somebody thinks is better, right? That's not necessarily a bug in the software functionality. I mean, it's not necessarily a security bug, but it's clearly a bug, something's not correct. So the main way to think about it, when we go back to what is security, so I think of it as a bug is something that allows an attacker, allows somebody to violate one of these properties of the software. So to violate confidentiality, integrity, or availability of the system. Cool. So which brings us then to software insecurity, right? So software is buggy because humans are imperfect. We're writing software that is not perfect. And a software bug or fault, as we said, may or may not be a security bug or a security vulnerability. This is kind of a key point, so I think thinking in terms of so a vulnerability is something like a bug that exists. You could say this vulnerability exists in the code. There is, on line 50, there's a statement that is not only a bug, but can allow an attacker to, let's say, completely take over this application. Or like in a web application, it could allow an attacker access to our entire database. Right, so when a bug is actually triggered, when somebody like maliciously exploit, like triggers that bug, we call that an exploit. So this is something, one of the important things, so security is kind of this field that's full of jargon and terms, and this is actually a subtle distinction that will demonstrate that you know about security, is being able to talk about vulnerabilities different from exploits, right? So when I say like, oh, they found a vulnerability in whatever, some libc version, you would know, oh, there's a bug that exists somewhere in some code somewhere, which may or may not have an exploit, because you may not even have to demonstrate that you could control it. Oftentimes it's enough to just say, hey, look, there's a vulnerability here, somebody could do this, and then you should let things will fix that in that way. So that's what we think of when I think of software insecurities, all the ways that software can break. And so software security is super easy, right? Just write perfect software and buy perfect hardware, right? But is this actually enough? So let's assume that you could write perfect software. Like, let's say it's easy. You just write perfect software. You throw it through some magic program that can't exist, but let's assume that it does, that says, yes, this software is 100% secure. So is this enough? Yeah. Yeah, but I'm awesome. I can make it super fast and secure. I can choose all three. Yeah.
Sometimes the platform on which the software runs, maybe that is a problem.
Say it again?
The platform on which the
software
runs.
So the software is not running in isolation, right? The application is running on some operating system, but I'm awesome. I've coded my own operating system that's perfectly secure. And I've coded my own firmware that's perfectly secure. And I'm running perfectly secure hardware. Is that enough?
The users are not.
The users, why do I care about the users?
Because they can introduce vulnerabilities by doing things incorrectly. That constricted web-based is the software.
Yeah, so you have maybe the admins, if they're doing things correctly. You have the users themselves. What if my users are, every user in my system has their password as password, right? Or if I have a user account admin, and some my policy says nobody unauthorized should access my system, and a bad guy just types in admin, and then gets in. The code's 100% correct, right? The code, that software is 100% secure, but I'm not considering my users in terms of security. So is that right? Well, I can actually write software perfectly secure. I can write my software perfectly secure. I can have perfect users, but I need to actually configure that software correctly. So it's incredibly, so I'll tell a story. Back when I was an undergrad, I had this website that I was running, and I had some problem with, I can't remember what it was, some permission issue, and it was a Linux machine, and I was very new at admitting Linux systems, and so it said, permission error. So I was like, I'll just chmod slash to 777, which is everything gets all permissions. And let me tell you, that bug went away. Everything works perfectly. This is like a common refrain, is everything works perfectly when it's running as root and we have all the permissions, right? But then actually what happened, so to finish that, is I logged off that machine and I couldn't SSH back into the machine because now my authorized key file in SSH was publicly readable, and so I had to file a support ticket, and they're like, oh my gosh, what did you do to this machine? I was like, I don't know, things weren't working, and I just like fixed it. So, but if I was running something important on there and my permissions are just all open, right, that could open up avenues for attack that aren't necessarily in the software itself, but because of how the system was configured or administered. So this does have some user components, right? Like, I probably shouldn't, well, it was my server, so I should have root on it, but. And it goes to, if we assume just our software is secure, right? We have our operating systems, we have the firmware, we have the hardware, we have all these other pieces that could potentially break. And so this is actually important to think about. So this is why we have vulnerabilities, why vulnerabilities exist. Perfect hypervisor. I think that's the one we didn't talk about. So it's hard to have, I mean, you know, it's kind of actually crazy. I think constantly that, like, what are we doing where this all actually works? Like, I don't know, planes still fly, money gets sent around, like, you all signed up for classes on an online system, all your information is stored in all these databases, and yet everything, it's like everything is clearly insecure, but it all still kind of works somehow, so that's nice. So how do you develop secure software? So if we say 100% secure software is impossible, should we just give up? Say, time to go home, let's just write whatever garbage code we think we should, and if it's functional and it works, then we just call it a day. A lot easier that way. Although I wouldn't have a job, and none of you would, security wouldn't be interesting. So how do we develop secure software? So what are some things that we can do?
Identify vulnerabilities, like doing a pen test or something like that.
Yeah, so we can hire somebody to tell us all the problems in our software, right? So we go can hire somebody who claims they're knowledgeable about security to find problems. So let's say they find five things, and you fix all those five things. Does that mean you're secure? Why not?
Because we don't know, because they might not be perfect.
Right. So it's an interesting situation, right? It's because we definitely know we've improved. We've gotten more secure than before we did this pen test. But we actually don't have a way to prove that we definitely are really secure, right? There could be, this company may be terrible. They may be experts in one area, but you have a ton of bugs in another area, right? What are some other ways?
A static analysis tool?
A static analysis tool, what's that?
Like a linter or something that specifically is looking for security, known security, coding security.
Yeah, so we can buy tools that look at our source code and look for either patterns or they reason about or try to analyze the code to say, hey, there could be a potential vulnerability here. And those tools are interesting because depending on the kind that you use, some of them can be, you can get one, so I can easily write a tool that can find every single vulnerability in your code. Would you buy that tool? Why not?
Because it may not work for someone else. It might be too late.
No, it will. It'll find all their vulnerabilities in anybody's program.
In anyone's?
Any program.
Okay. Ship it?
You want to buy it? Who wants to give me money? I'll put my Bitcoin on and dress up after class. Oh, it's super easy. You can do this too. Just print out on line one, there's this vulnerability. On line two, there's this vulnerability, the same vulnerability. You say there's every vulnerability exists on every single line. And then there we go. I've definitely found all the vulnerabilities in your program. What's the problem with that?
It's not scalable. What if new vulnerability comes in?
I'll just add it to my list and I'll spit it out too.
You're not specific.
Yeah, I'm not actually telling you, I'm not giving you information. I may have found all the vulnerabilities, but I've given you so much information that I haven't narrowed it down. So there's a lot of false positives in there, right? Where I said there's a vulnerability, but it doesn't actually exist, right? It's an interesting thing to think about. So static analysis tools can have this problem where they'll say, hey, there's a vulnerability here, and you'll spend an hour investigating and then come to the conclusion that it does not. And now you've lost all faith and trust in this tool. So you're like, screw, why would I ever listen to these reports? I just waste my time on them, right? So it's a really interesting trade-off. The flip side of that, though, is I've built some static analysis tools where I looked at the results and was like, this tool's broken. Like, this is clearly not a vulnerability. And I like stared at it for longer, and I realized, oh my gosh, is this correct? Like, if you go through these crazy code paths, it's actually vulnerable. So we can do that. Some other techniques. Somebody talked about spending a bunch of money. So we spend a bunch of money. So there are various levels of code certification that you go through, that you develop engineering process where essentially every code change is like double and triple checked, and you have insane amounts of validation and testing. But, you know, how much are you willing to pay for a piece of software? You're gonna pay $5, $10, or $5 million or $10 million, right? So it's definitely increasing the cost. And for some things like airplanes, that's worth it, or nuclear reactors or something like that, right? But for everyday software, that's not always the case. So it's important to think about these things. So how does software break? So this is really going to be the key thing. Like, when you leave this course, I want you to be able to look at not just a piece of software, but most things, and think, how does it break? So this is kind of developing that tester mindset of how does software break? And really, what we're focused on here is developing not just an average tester, like, how could this thing break? Like, somebody brought up the thing on a website where you have a drop-down list and one of the buttons doesn't work. Like, I don't care about that as a security person. But what I care about is how can I make that website give me all its usernames and passwords or steal all the credit card information, right? And so this is what you have to develop. It's kind of like, anyone ever get locked out of their house before? No key? What's the first thing you start doing?
Calling everybody.
Trying to break in, right?
Looking for other ways to get in.
Yeah, you look for other ways to get in, right? You start like breaking into your own house. You start like jiggling the lock. Like, maybe you left the front door unlocked. Go around the back, maybe you left the back door unlocked. You start scoping out the windows, right? How close are the trees to my house? Is there anything I can get to that second story window? Because I know that the window on the second floor is unlocked in the bathroom, So I know if I could get up there, I can scoot it over, pop out the screen, and then get into the house, right? And when you get in, it feels awesome, right? And then you think, like, I just broke in my house, how easy was that? But the problem is you only have this mindset when you're in this situation that demands it. And so what this course is about, really to be a good security professional, is you need to develop this mindset, and that's what we're gonna be doing. You'll be looking at pieces of software and trying to figure out, how can I break this? How can I make it do something it's not supposed to do? So you need to develop always this questioning and inquisitive mindset of, well, what if I did this? Or what if I did this? Like, what if I pushed here? Or what if, like, you're developing kind of hypotheses of vulnerabilities. You wanna think about, where does this data go? Who processes this data? I've seen on the web, cross-site scripting vulnerabilities that can come in from a tweet. So the company will pull onto their website, let's say recently made tweets. And so you can actually, if you can get your tweet to load there, you can get some JavaScript to run, and now you have control of their website. It's super crazy to think about. Because it's not content, but you always gotta think of, where is this data coming from? A key is, what assumptions is the system making? So what did the developer not think about? Because they're, you know, we make assumptions all the time. So I was telling Adam and Connor one example of a student who, I think it was in this class, probably 2 years ago, was like, I don't understand, my code is 100% correct, I'm looking at it, it works flawlessly on my machine, I've made all these test cases, but when I submit it to your system, it says it doesn't pass any test cases. This happens a lot, by the way. And it is never the submission server, by the way. It's never that environment. I think that happens one out of like 1,000 times, and it's like the first person to submit. And so, you know, I go, they send me their code, and immediately I see what the problem is. They're opening a file, so you have to open this file, and it was /home/username/whatever, right? So they were making an assumption that they were running on their machine with access to that file, but that was not in the description, right? So this is one of these things where you need to constantly be thinking, put your mind in the mind of the developer, right? You've written software. You know how lazy you can be sometimes. It's not a judgment call. I'm lazy like all the time, especially when coding, right? Why do extra work coding when you don't have to? So put yourself in that mind of that developer or that intern who wrote this feature that maybe doesn't understand the security implications. Yeah.
I'll go back to submissions. So before the due date, how often can you submit? Is it just once or?
It'll be multiple times. We'll get there when we get there. Don't worry about it now. So you always want to be thinking and trying to understand what assumptions were made here. And really the big way to do this and to understand this is to get hands-on experience of breaking software. So this is really the key of this course is I can stand up here, I can lecture all day, I can teach you about various vulnerability classes. You can understand them in an intellectual way, like, ah, yes, buffer overflow, it's so simple. You just overwrite the safety IP that's on the stack. And then I put you in front of a program and go like, hey, find the vulnerability here, and by the way, write a buffer overflow that actually exploits that and changes the EIP to something that you control that gives you access. And then you have to start dealing with real world problems, and that completely changes your mind and your understanding of these vulnerabilities. So, and this is something that I know from talking with students who've gotten jobs after here, this is something that employers really like too. They want security people who can actually do things and not just say, ah, yes, I know, I can explain buffer overflows or format strings or whatever until the cows come home. But so you can really put fingers to keyboard, that's when you can really do it. So any questions on this stuff? This isn't the end of the class, by the way. We got more. Go. Cool.
Just in terms of how the lecture is being recorded?
Yes. Okay. Oh, yeah, did I not mention that? Yeah, the lectures are recorded, so I should be recording this now. I post them all on YouTube, roughly-ish after class, maybe take a day or so, but I'll try to be quick as I can with that. So if I haven't uploaded a lecture, just ping me. This is not a guarantee, though. I'm not guaranteeing, so because stuff happens sometimes, sometimes the audio is really crappy because I'll forget the mic sometimes, or sometimes, I don't know, like if it crashes halfway through and I lose a whole half a lecture, I'm not going to redo that. So that's on you. So use it really to, I think the best way probably to be successful as this class is come to class, participate in the discussion. I try to have a discussion style class. Don't worry so much about writing down every little thing I say, because I will try to record most things. And just absorb and participate, and I think you'll get a lot out of it that way rather than, I mean, I know, you know, you can just go be in your home and watch the lectures at 2x speed or whatever, and that's fine. I mean, whatever. You're paying for this, not me, so do whatever you want.
Is it the breaking software illegal?
Ah, no. We will not be doing anything illegal in this course. Ethics, because I'm going to talk about people going to jail here, so. That was a good lead-in. So great, okay. So history, so we have to, this is, you know, computer science and computer security is not, you know, wasn't established in the 1500s. So the history is relatively short, but still I think it's important to appreciate and understand the history to put things in the historical context. So you can understand kind of the evolution of not only famous security problems, but also people that were involved, kind of the history. And we'll take this approach to other aspects too. We'll look at kind of historical attacks and vulnerabilities, because we're trying to get out of them what are the trends here. So the internet, does anybody not use the internet today? Are some of you using the internet right now? Right? Is anyone genuinely feel like they did not use the internet at all today? I think it's possible, but highly unlikely. So the internet, we're gonna study, look at all the protocols. Essentially, a network of networks. It's insane. So I'm gonna go fast on this because I wanna get to some meat, but the internet's critical to our lives. I think we can all agree on that, right? So the internet, if you are not aware, was started by DARPA. So this is actually one of the big claim to fames, obviously, of DARPA, one of the most successful projects that they've ever done. And this is a good kind of advertisement for why research is important, right? They didn't know they were going to be creating this communication infrastructure that was going to completely change the way we live our lives, but they did, right? And it's really cool that it came from that. So the first four nodes in 1969 was UCLA, UCSB, Stanford Research Institute, and they added one more. Why do you think they added one more? Put yourself in the program manager's shoes at DARPA. You're gonna fund some kind of weird networking thing that you don't really understand what it's gonna be, and they're claiming all this crazy stuff. Why would you add a fourth one? Because, you know, think about a network. You don't need two, you need at least three people. But why add a fourth one just to complicate things?
Redundancy.
What was it?
Redundancy.
Redundancy? No, that they were. They're thinking about making things work, I think, at this point. Yeah.
Load balancing, maybe.
Oh. Well.
As a backup.
What was that?
As a backup?
Nope. Yeah.
They wanted one outside of California?
Yes, they wanted one outside of this political, basically. Right? Because they wanted to say that they're funding people not all California, right? So, at least that's the story. That's the story that I've heard. I think it makes a lot of sense. This is actually the napkin, a picture of the napkin where the first architecture of the internet was laid out. So yeah, UCSB, my alma mater, is here, which is pretty cool. And yeah, it's because you can think about it, you just like put off Utah. Although you do have interesting things here, now SRI has like, you know, choices of where they want things to go. So that does actually make it interesting rather than just the triangle. So yeah, so this, it's literally insane to think about. It came just from these four places, right? And it was based on NCP, which we're not really gonna go into too much. Transition to the TCP that we know and love now in 1983. The MILNET, so the military network, is actually a completely separate network from the current internet. This is an incredibly important thing. I love this little fact that NSF created this crazy supercomputer network supported by a backbone of 56 kilobits per second in 1986. But that must have seemed like insanely fast. So the 90s and the 2000s, what was the big game here? What was that?
Worldwide.
Who said that? Yeah.
Worldwide.
Yeah, WWW, right? The World Wide Web, right? So before, You know, so this is actually another important thing to part of jargon to make sure when you're talking about the internet as a whole, the internet, the interconnected series of networks or all autonomous networks, and the World Wide Web and the web, right? They're actually separate things. The web is just one of the protocols that runs on top of the internet. In addition, other protocols that existed before the web were like FTP and mail, email predates the web, all these kind of things. Probably telnet, but I'm running out of things. So, and this is when things started to explode and go crazy. And this is when the internet came from something that like weird academics use to like send each other emails on a computer terminal. Like, who would ever want to do that as part of their everyday lives? To this insane thing that we all use and use every day. So, and this is how fast it went from. It is insane to think about. 1991, right? By the end of the 90s, we had the first dot-com bubble. And it literally, now Sir Tim Berners-Lee created the first version of the World Wide Web at CERN. And it got crazy from there. So we can look at, like, these are growth numbers from 99 to 2015 of, what are these? Oh, the number of websites, the number of sites on the web, how it's grown over time. This is a, what was that?
Is that new sites or is that?
I think it's websites, total. like a crawl of just websites. So this isn't even users, so users is probably growing much faster than the number of servers. And this is like a graphic of all of that. It doesn't show up very well. That's fine. It's just really complicated and cool, all these networks talking to each other, the graphs of the data. You can pull up all kinds of ridiculous facts about how big the internet is. I mean, even Facebook itself, when you think about that, like, there are, what, more than a billion active users in a month or something crazy like that? Like, that's just, this is from 1991. Like, literally, it was nothing until 1991. So, I love thinking about that. So going into security, so you can actually trace the origins of modern computer security to Captain Crunch boxes. So the reason is, so it started with what we now call phone phreaking. So I know it's crazy to think about that back in the day, you actually had to pay like per phone call and it was pretty expensive. It wasn't just like you have unlimited calls, although we have that now and nobody ever calls anybody, they just text. But it turns out that phone line, so for you to make like an international call was a lot of money. You're paying per minute a lot of money to make a phone call. And so what some enterprising people found out is that the way that the phone network, like your terminal, like your literal telephone would talk to other, like the switches at the network, was be through sounds over that same channel. So, and what John Draper, so his nickname is Captain Crunch, he found out that this whistle that came as like a free thing in these Captain Crunch cereal boxes would blow at exactly that frequency of 2600. And so he could use that. You would open the phone call, you'd blow, and that would be the signal for the terminal to tell the switch that this is a like a free, like the call's been paid for, and so you could use that to make free phone calls. And this is on AT&T, I believe, yeah, it must have been in the Monopoly days, so they owned basically the entire phone network. And so this is when phone phreaking was born. So he built this blue box, and it turns out 2600 wasn't the only frequency. So what these people did is they essentially reverse engineered the phone system completely from the outside, messing with and playing with all these audio frequencies to figure out how to figure out the different tones to make to do different things. So not only could you do different, like make phone calls for free, which is like practically interesting, but you could like route your call from your machine to like a machine in Russia or to a switch in Russia to a switch over here. Like you could tell it how to route your call and do all kinds of crazy stuff. And he was eventually sentenced to 5 years probation for phone fraud. His story's actually really sad. You can look it up if you're interested. But he was eventually caught, and he's for perpetuating fraud against the telephony systems. And so, you know, this is really interesting because this led to the birth of kind of modern hacking, right? It's all about people exploring systems and using knowledge in order to do things that the system wasn't authorized to do or wasn't supposed to do. Yeah.
Wozniak did the same, but he didn't get it.
Yes, Woz had a lot of weird stuff with phone networks. Like he had a, I think he built a joke a day box, like a phone box that you could call into and give out jokes. And oh yeah, that's right. Yeah, he built a box too.
I thought it was a blue box, but
interesting. I think, I don't know, I'm not a lawyer, by the way, started this, but I think building the box is probably not illegal because it's just a tool that makes noises. Maybe, I don't know how much sway he has over the lobbies, but he definitely used it illegally. And so I think that was more of what came there. So, and really this is going to be a theme over and over. And when I think about security is not like this magical domain of crazy hackers who just like are brilliant and just look at something and be like, aha, it is broken here, you just type this and it's done. Right? It's a lot of hard work, but more than that, it's about just knowledge. Like, you just understand how all these layers work, and you can use that knowledge to make a system do something it wasn't supposed to do. And that's really all that it is at the end of the day. So this is actually why I love security, is it's about knowledge. And so literally anyone can do this. All of you have the potential for security inside you. You just need to put in the time and the effort, and you'll be awesome. Cool. So, in the early days of the ARPANET, there was RFC number 602. What's an RFC?
Request for comments.
Request for comments. What actually is it?
So it has, like, for a protocol, it has all the information regarding it, has, like, the error information or...
Yeah, it's used,
or not everything.
It's used to kind of usually offer proposed new protocols. I think it's the Internet Engineering Task Force manages the RFCs, but I don't know that's correct off the top of my head, so... It is. Thanks. I appreciate that. But it's also, there's really funny RFCs. So there's an RFC for transmitting TCP/IP packets over pigeons, like a pigeon net. And so Bob Metcalf wrote this thing called "The Stockings Were Hung by the Chimney with Care." So this is super interesting because you can already see some of the seeds back here in 1973 about what the potential problems could be here. So I'll read some of this. So, individual sites used to physical limitations on machine access have not yet taken sufficient precautions towards securing their systems against unauthorized remote use. Sounds familiar. This happens all the time, as people don't think that they're now connected to the internet, where literally anyone on earth can attack their machine. Right? We're used to thinking about it. It's very natural to think about it in terms of our physical security, but that doesn't necessarily exist on the net. For example, many people still use passwords that are easy to guess. Wow, are easy to guess passwords still a problem? Yes, literally everywhere. Yes, okay, so TIP. So TIP is access over the phone networks. TIP allows access to ARPANET to a much wider audience than is thought or intended. Actually, right around this time, so Dick Kemmerer, who is now an emeritus professor at UC Santa Barbara, he was actually around right when they were doing all this, in the early stages of the internet, and he actually has a phone book, I believe it was mid-late 70s, of the internet, and it's literally like, here's this IP address, is administered by this person, and this is their phone number, and how to contact them. And it's only this big. Literally everyone who was using the internet at that time was known to everyone else. But now here, they introduce new interesting features that give people access that they didn't think about beforehand. The TIP requires no user identification before getting service. How horrible. And thus, many people, including those who used to spend their time ripping off Mavel, this is the phone freakers, the people who, so this is literally, he's stating, people transition from learning how to hack the phone network to how to hack computer systems. Give access to our stockings in a most anonymous way. There is lingering affection for the challenge of breaking someone's system. This affection lingers despite the fact that everyone knows that it's easy to break systems, even easier to crash them. So there's actually still I think the thing here that's really persisted is this part at the end, like denial of service and availability attacks are usually super lame because that's really easy to take a system down. What's more interesting is how to take it over and exploit it. And I'd say now it's changed where it's actually much cooler to break things because of how secure things have gotten. We think about it, it's like, it'd be like going to a town and being like the best thief in the world because everyone leaves their door, like they don't even have doors. Like everyone just has an open square that you just walk into and take everything you want, right? You're like not super awesome at that point, but modern vulnerabilities are pretty awesome and require a huge depth of knowledge. All of this would be quite humorous and cause for raucous eye-winking and elbow-nudging if it weren't for the fact that in recent weeks at least two major serving hosts were crashed under suspicious circumstances by people who knew what they were risking. And yet a third system, so crashes again being a problem, a third system, the system wheel password, which is like the root password or the admin password, was compromised by two high school students in Los Angeles, no less. Silly kids with nothing to do but hack systems. We suspect that the number of dangerous security violations is larger than any of us know is growing, right? So here, this is actually a key thing of that. Actually, these are only cases that have been found and reported, right? This is a classic security problem where, yes, if you find an intrusion and report it, you found and done something. But what about, like we talked about a pen test, what about the things they didn't find? What about the people who are actually inside your network that you don't know about, right? So probably this number is much larger. And we're advised not to just sit here and do nothing. So the next super interesting thing was the German hacker incident, which is probably a super cool name. This would make for a good movie, I think, if they could figure this out. So Cliff Stoll was a system admin at Lawrence Berkeley Laboratories, August of 1986. He's not a computer person. I mean, he's not a computer scientist in the traditional sense. He was not a security person because that term didn't literally exist yet. He was just a physics student who wanted to do physics work, and he was tasked with adminning their mainframe that charged people for how much they used the system. And on his first day, think about this, like this, you can see how like the start of this, the German hacker incident, and it starts with he started on his very first day, he looked at the accounting and found out that 75 cents were missing. And even though this was in 1986, I still don't think 75 cents was a lot of money back then, right? So, He started looking at this and said, wow, we used this much CPU, but we only charge like this much, with that gap being 75 cents worth of time. So I'm sure many of us, I probably would be the same, be like, oh, that's weird, like, whatever. Like, I don't know, I haven't worked retail. Is this enough where they would like cause problems if your till was short 75 cents?
No.
No? Yeah, I would think that's in like a range where it'd be fine, but who knows. So he dug in, and this is where things got interesting. He found that an account had been created with no billing address. What? More investigation basically identified the presence of an intruder. So they ended up finding that somebody was inside their systems. And then, so he contacts, now at this point he freaks out, contacts FBI, all these agencies. They basically say, yeah, go ahead, do whatever you can do to find out more information. So he developed like a way to tap and see when people were calling in, to see like the commands that they were running on the system in real time. So the hacker gained, I'm skimming over the technical details, but basically found a vulnerability in their, I think, sendmail program and used that to gain access and created accounts, fake accounts, backdoor programs. He connected through there to the Milnet, so they were doing, they were connected to the military network. They searched military sites and databases for keywords such as SDI, the Strategic Defense Initiative, Stealth, SAC, the Strategic Air Command, Nuclear, and NORAD. And this is at the point where we call the FBI. It's like, okay, this is clearly not somebody who's just stealing computer time. He called the FBI. And they were actually able to trace this call. So it came, they were calling in from a phone line. They traced that call with the help of AT&T back to Hanover in Germany. And this actually ended, they actually arrested the person responsible for this in 1989, who apparently worked for the Eastern Bloc. And he was sentenced to 1 year and 8 months probation, and other people were actually found tied up in this. If this sounds like a super interesting story, and it is, there is a book called The Cuckoo's Egg that Cliff Stoll wrote that is freaking amazing. Like, I loved reading this book, and it's still, like, it's interestingly technical, and it's I think it's a Unix system, so the things are kind of familiar, and he explains it. He talks about his whole process and like how they found out and how they kind of traced it back, and it gives a really interesting idea in kind of the first days of security of the web, which led then to the internet worm. So the very first internet worm was released on 1988, which was by RTM, Robert Tappan Morris, who's now, I believe, still a professor. He's a professor at MIT, I believe. And this wouldn't have been such a big deal, except there was a mistake in the replication process. So basically, this worm would scan for other computers on the local and outside networks. It would identify if they had a vulnerable version. It actually had four different vulnerabilities it would try. It would try those vulnerabilities, it would get into the machine, and then it was supposed to check, is this machine already infected, and then stop. And then if it wasn't infected, it would replicate, copy itself over there, compile it, run it on that machine, which would scan other machines. So you can see it spreads in this virus-like manner. The problem is that this detection mechanism of is it running was broken. And so you get exploited again and again and again, slowing down your system and grinding things to a halt. The internet literally had to be turned off. So they had to coordinate with each other, call everyone, shut off the internet, patch all their systems, and turn it back on. Because you couldn't even patch the system because it was getting so many calls and things were running. Like, it was crazy. He was sentenced to 3 years probation, a $10,000 fine, and 400 hours of community service. And I believe his dad was, maybe I shouldn't say that. All right. You can look up his story because I don't want to say anything that's false. So they actually, in response to this, the Computer Emergency Response Team, CERT, if you've ever seen vulnerability notifications through CERT, they came out of this. And so, super interesting, it had a main program and a bootstrap program. It first used a buffer overflow in the finger program, which I'm gonna show you the code for, and it's incredibly simple. You'll know how to exploit this type of vulnerability in the future. And the send mail program had a debug option that allows somebody to specify a command to run on that system, literally like a backdoor in the debugging functionality. So this goes back to somebody's comment about like user functionality and user experience versus security, right? Like, it would be awesome to have a debug way if you're debugging some server, like why isn't it working? We'll just run this command. So it transferred literally a C program because not every system was, you know, the same architecture. So transfer a C program, compile it, run it, and then transfer other versions. I'm going to skip over this a little bit, but it basically tried to look for every single host that was known to this machine to propagate. You can read kind of a history here, and it is really good. We'll finish real quick. Kevin Mitnick is one of the most famous hackers. He like was hacking from a young age, broke into several different things. He actually then, like, after all of this, was wanted by the FBI, or by the US Marshals. He was one of like America's most wanted for computer stuff. And he has a whole thing where he was into creating fake identities, and he went underground. He finally was released from prison after 5 years. And when he could not connect to the internet, more recently, Albert Gonzalez, I love this story. So he and his crew used a web vulnerability, SQL injection, to steal credit cards. In total, they stole 170 million credit cards. He was responsible for the David Ruster's breach in 2008, the TJ Maxx in 2008, Heartland Payment Systems, which literally managed credit card transactions. So you'd scan a credit card, some of them would go to Heartland Payment Systems, and they got into their systems and basically just wrote something to collect all these numbers and siphon them back. And he, in March 2010, was sentenced to 20 years in federal prison, which is a long time. And so this actually, I like this story because not only were they like hackers super in the underground, Rolling Stone wrote this really great article about them. This would also probably make a cool movie. The Fast Times and Hard Fall of the Green Hat Gang. They apparently did a lot of drugs along with their hacking exploits. So they would hack, do drugs, party with all this fake money that they have. Like, I don't know, it's like insane reading about all of their crazy stuff that they got into. So some other interesting things. This person was a former employee of the company that ran a sewage systems in Australia. He got fired and they did not terminate his access. So he caused raw sewage to overflow in all their sewage systems, and literally it was like flooding the coasts, and like, yeah, thousands, you know. Actually, this is kind of sad. I mean, it's funny and also sad, like marine life died. Like, it was really terrible. And so he was sentenced to 2 years in prison. All kinds of crazy worms and stuff that all ended badly, so I guess I'm gonna